Hello, welcome to Tap That MTG, the show where we tell you everything we know about magic that's probably wrong, but fun to talk about. I'm Shauna.
I'm Leslie.
And today we are bringing you another card that, another companion card from the Ikoria set. We thought we'd do a little series on these strange companions. Leslie, what's companion?
What's a companion? Well, let me tell you, you are an amazing companion. But in the world of magic, companion cards are cards that basically give you some rules around building a deck, and then your companion sits off to the side in a special little area that we'll call the companion zone right now. And at any time when you feel that it's time to play it, you can play it from that companion zone. It's kind of like a commander, only you can't replay it if it dies, so you have to find different ways of bringing it back from the graveyard if you need to, or perhaps have multiples if it fits within your deck to have it in your thing. So basically it's just a separate little card you can play whenever you want, and it doesn't count towards your 60 card.
Nice.
So you can have 61 cards.
So there is a special rule that comes along with all of them, though.
Mm-hmm.
So this one in particular that we're doing today is called Umori the Collector. So his special rule is that each non-land card in your starting deck shares a card type. So you have to, as it enters the battlefield, you have to choose the card type. So card type is whether it's in the middle. So whether it's a creature or a planeswalker or whatever, it all has to be the same. So creature is probably your best bet here, because this deck is all about, this card is all about being able to cast your creatures. So it says spells you cast of the chosen type cost one less to cast. So you want to be able to cast those big creatures for less and take advantage of that, being able to get those out faster and running over your opponent.
Mm-hmm. So in recent days, I mean, this will evolve, this companion thing will evolve, but with Ikoria, of course, there's a lot of mutate cards coming out. There's some key cards that we think you should put in a deck, but really you could go mono black, you could go mono green, or you could go any combination of anything within that, as long as you have the mana base. So this one actually that we have seen being played uses Poliwog Symbiote, so then we throw blue in there, and that makes every creature that one less to cast if it has mutate on it, because you're wanting to take advantage of multiple triggers for mutate, and your creatures are going to be less to cast as well as your mutate creatures are going to be less to cast, so it just kind of gets them out really, really fast.
Yeah.
You're definitely going to need some mana ramp in this deck. And we won't talk about ways to do mana ramp. You guys are smart enough, you can figure out mana ramp all on your own, but Poliwog Symbiote is definitely a key card in this. One thing I did notice, Shauna, though, as I was playing, is because the Poliwog Symbiote has the you draw a card, then discard a card.
Right.
If you have no cards in hand, that can really kick you in the butt. So I have four in my deck, but when I do my sideboard, I usually sideboard two of them out and put in some more removal or something like that, depending on what I want to do.
Right.
I definitely want four, but you can kind of play with that and see what you like. What are the mutate cards in this deck that you've seen?
A really, really strong mutate card that is in here right now in a lot of the decks is the Aluna Apex of Wishes.
Mm-hmm.
So that beast elemental dinosaur, so you can imagine how big this thing is. It's a 6/6 flying trample, huge, gigantic thing that does have mutate. And whenever this creature mutates, exile cards from the top of your library until you exile a non-land permanent, which is everything else, and put that card onto the battlefield or into your hand. So you can choose whether you want to play that thing. But that's just getting you a free creature out on the battlefield. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. And then Auspicious Strix does kind of the same thing. It's another 6/6. Its mutate cost is 6, and whenever this creature mutates, exile cards from the top of your library, exile X permanent cards, where X is the number of times this creature is mutated, and then put those permanents including land, onto the battlefield. So you get land from that, which is nice mana ramp. You get creatures from that onto the battlefield. It can kick you in the butt because sometimes you get things onto the battlefield without being able to mutate them. Mm-hmm. Like your, you know, you'll get your apex or whatever onto the battlefield, which is great. And you shouldn't complain about that.
Because you just got a 6/6 on the battlefield for free.
Right. But I'm like, it didn't happen the way I wanted to. Or you'll get some of your mana ramp ones out there and you won't get a chance to kind of like do that extra thing with them. But great card. And then I guess the other key card, I'll let you talk about the last key card that we talked about. The Forerunner.
Okay, sure. So it is the Forerunner. The Enraze Forerunner is that crazy little boar from Ravnica time here that has vigilance, trample, and haste. And when it comes out, it enters battlefield and other creatures you control get +2/+2 and vigilance and trample. So that's a really great card to play for free. So you really hope that you get that one out for free and then you just run them over with all the creatures that you have. So it's a little bit insane.
Yeah. So the hope is that you'll get that one out for free or that some of these ones will come out for free. But I think the key with this deck is definitely mana ramp. You have to have mana ramp in there. Yep. So things like your Paradise Druids and your Arboreal Grazers, things that let you play extra mana or get you extra mana. There's the Migratory Great Horn that you can mutate and get another land. Because I've played this deck with the Enraze Forerunner and actually hard cast that from my hand.
Right.
Because it's in my hand, because you have enough land. And in fact, if you've built your deck right, you'll have
more than enough land to play any of these hard cast and then just
more than those extra triggers after the fact. So
because a lot of the decks that we see in the play right now are really fast decks, so this is making your big stompy decks into a fast deck to be able to compete against those fast decks.
And it really slows them down, right? Because they have these really big decks and now they can't even come in at you because you have a 6/6 out on the battlefield. Parcel Beast is another one that we see as a key card in here because it has the tap, pay one and tap to look at the top card of your library, and if it's a land then you get to put it onto the battlefield, so there's your mana ramp. And if not, then you get to put it in your hand, so you get that extra card draw regularly. You get to basically see what's coming up and do that right before you decide right before they pass turn on their end step, and then you have it as a blocker. It's a nice 2/4. So
another really, really good card to have in a deck like this one is a card like Voracious Hydra. Because again, you're going to have lots of mana there. You're going to be able to play this with 6 counters on it and then mutate on that. So you mutate the 6/6, and with mutate, you put the card on top. And so basically you've got the 6/6 plus the 6 counters from the Voracious Hydra at the beginning. And now you've got a 12/12 with trample. So that's a really, really good card to have in a mutate deck. Plus it's removal for you if you need to use that. It's really great for that. Or you can double the counters, or it's such a versatile card.
Yeah. You also talked about Stonecoil Serpent.
Oh yes, Stonecoil Serpent is a really, really good one to have. Even if you just have it in your sideboard again, because if you're going against some of those humans decks or something like that that has lots of multicolored, it's totally protected against multicolored, so you can just run them over. It's awesome.
And then we've also seen some people playing with black in this deck as well. So Dirge Bat. Basically, look at all your mutate stuff and figure out kind of what does your best high impact. So Dirge Bat is one of those because when it mutates, you get to destroy target creature or planeswalker the opponent controls. So you have that constant removal and you're going to be, you know, mutating and getting all of those other mutate benefits as you go. So this is definitely a really good card or a really good companion to play with a mutate deck. Interesting though, because when you think about it, you could go mono green creatures and do something like Questing Beast and some of those big stompy creatures with...
I have tried it in a few of those decks.
Yeah. Have you seen a lot of success with that?
Mostly what happens with that is that it's too slow is the biggest thing, which is funny because you have the mana ramp and stuff available to you. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. It's been kind of a 50-50 with that. That one, and I've done it with some black and green stuff because I do like Garouk and all that stuff. So that's kind of fun to do too, but I can't do... Then I have to have all Planeswalkers if I use it as a companion. So often with those kinds of decks, it's better to have just all creatures in there, mm-hmm. and then you don't have any removal, which is difficult.
Yeah. Really good companion for those creature decks out there. So definitely, if you have an opportunity to play with it, we'd love to hear what you're doing with it. Are you doing some other crazy shenanigans? Let us know in the comments down below, or you can reach out to us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Twitch. We're on all of the things.
Everywhere.
We want to hear from you. We hope that this was helpful for you to figure out how to use Umori as one of your companions. And until next time,
tap those magic cards and have fun doing it.
See you later, guys.